California to score for films. So I encourage you all to be looking for his name in future credits as they roll. And I'm sure that he will be there. And our very own Matthew Socey, who you probably know from film sociology or other WFYI programming, as his on-air counterpart to Stephen Stolen, as well as Pledge Drive guru and fundraiser. So at this time, please help me welcome Matt and Shane.
Good evening. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, please, no photos of me. No bootleg photos of me, please. That's, nobody wants those. Thank you for coming. We appreciate it. I guess we're going to start with, we're just going to, it's like a jazz jam session. We'll see where this winds up. We'll land safely. Start with the very first movie that ever had an impact on me. Also was involving with the film score. It was the summer of 1975. I was at a movie theater with my father and mother and my grandfather on Long Beach Island, New Jersey. It was Jaws. Yes, scared the living daylights out of me. My grandfather, who I thought was Ernest Hemingway, minus the hole in the head, walked out of the movie. He was a fisherman, and you know, terrifying, absolutely terrifying. And I'm fine. My parents they raised me well. But the next day, we went out to the beach in Beach Haven, New Jersey, and as he did, yeah, my father picked me up over his head and started marching toward the water, and just all he had to say was dun dun. Scared the living daylights out of me. And that, after I eventually calmed down and came to my senses years later, but that showed the power of film. And, of course, that brought the power of music. You know, if my dad, it'd be one thing if my dad lifted me up going, I'm going to throw you in the water, the shark to eat you. Well, that's, you know, weird parents do that. But just humming two notes, that's all it took, was two notes. And I lost my marbles. They're back now, but that's kind of where that was. And then as we were talking earlier, in a span of three years, you had the theme from Jaws, mm-hmm. the theme from Rocky by Bill Conti, and then the theme from Star Wars by John Williams, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So film music became, and films in general, became very impressionable on me at a young age. So that's where I was at. What about you?
Well, also, what's really funny about the Jaws score
was, right.
Yeah, it almost got thrown out. You know, you have this big, you know, motion picture coming out, and then John Williams comes up, oh, I got this awesome thing. It goes like this. Da-dun. Da-dun. Oh, it's awesome. You know, that almost got thrown out. So, but I would say the most memorable score for me was actually probably one of the first movies I've ever seen was actually Jurassic Park. Also John Williams, whenever the very beginning, whenever they're actually to the island and they see the giant brontosaurus, you know, getting all the leaves on top of the tree, the music's going, and then the cue is happening, and right as soon as the brontosaurus hits back on the ground, the big cue, da-na-na-na-na-da-da-da, and then just that part just still, you know, it still hits me today. Just right whenever you hear the echo of the dirt and the music cue at the same time. That's, to me, that's just the biggest part.
I think over time, film music or classical music in film is a great introduction to that type of music, especially, you know, I grew up in Michigan in the 70s. That's a lot of 70s rock music in my house because of my older brother. And hearing those scores, and it got to the point, and my daughter's 12, and she kind of went through this as well, where you know the music even though you've never seen the film. I know a lot of you could probably whistle The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, or you know the theme from The Godfather, or you know Dueling Banjos from Deliverance. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the impact that music has. We were talking earlier about classical music, especially in cartoons. Mm-hmm. You learn so much about classical music from the gang at Warner Brothers and, right. and other sources like that. And so my daughter's at a point now, she's been at a point where she'll go, I've heard this piece of music, what is it from? Or I heard a line from this film, what is it from? And sometimes I will show her just the clip, Other times, show her where mm-hmm. that particular music yes. came from.
So many times, you know, like you said, we have this melody that's stuck in our head, or we hear other people singing it, and you know, we were singing it ourselves, and even to this day, we don't know what it's coming from. What
right.
film?
There's a wonderful documentary which you should look for in your library or on Amazon. It's called A Great Day in Harlem. And it's a famous photo of all these jazz musicians in New York on the front stoop. Thank you, nodding heads. so all these great musicians, I think it was in the 50s. And in the 80s, they got interviews with a lot of the surviving members. And this is a story on this. One of the musicians told a story. He got up in the middle of the night, and he had a song in his head. And he wrote it down immediately. And he was really excited. You know, that because we've had thoughts, and then something about you, well, I'll remember it in the morning and or whatever, and you don't. And so he writes down these notes, and he goes to bed feeling really satisfied. And he gets up the next morning, he's really excited, he's going to go play this brand new opus that he's created, and he started playing it, and it was Stardust. So, music in your head. Mm-hmm. I guess we have an audio video, the AV Club. Thank you. There you go. We don't have a union guy to do that. Hi. We wanted to show the impact. So, for instance, like I said, when you know, if my dad put me over his head and didn't hum anything, or you know, it doesn't have the same effect. So, think about a favorite movie scene that you have, especially one that incorporates music. That kind of helps with this discussion. And think of that scene without the music. And we actually have an example of this. You created this, yeah. Sir.
So this is actually a big viral video that's going around. And you know, everyone here hopefully have seen Star Wars. And at the very end scene, when they're in the throne room, you know, when they're getting their awards on it, this has this giant processional by John Williams the whole time, you know, the kind of graduating music. And I'm going to play for you first what the music actually sounds like.
We're sorry if we, you know, spoiled the ending of a.
Okay. Now, what's really interesting is this scene here. This is the throne room scene without the music. And you
Decision. Yeah, now what? Hopefully you've not had a social situation like that.
But yeah, that's, for instance, that's a big pivotal scene that without the music, the whole scene is completely awkward and would not stand at all on a theater.
Dr. Jones running from the ball, a giant ball with no sound. Yeah, that's. Now, Here's the part of the reason why we're having this discussion is I'm doing this from the audience standpoint. Mm-hmm. I got a film show, yes, but he's a musician. I'm a member of the audience, so.
I can show you like examples of how to combat this awkwardness.
Please do.
For instance, you know what John Williams did. He put the processional there to, you know, make the whole scene come alive where it's just not awkward. You know, there's no words or anything like that. So I'm going to show you three different techniques that people actually put in films to give the different types of imagery. So first of all, we're going to start off with something called Mickey Mousing. Mickey Mousing is if I do a fall, if I fall down, the music will go. If I get back up, the music will follow me. If I do a step, you know, the music will actually follow my steps or motions and stuff like that. This is found most commonly in cartoons, stuff like Carl Stalling and stuff like that. So I want to show you this scene. This is whenever the Wile E. Coyote actually catches the road. Two things about that clip. By the way, ta-da. So, yeah. That's fun. I was only until later when I was paying attention more to the music. I had this image of the musicians in silly costumes when they were playing. I don't know why. I think part of it was, if you remember, I think it was the recording of Sgt. Pepper, and they had the orchestra in masks. They had these kind of funny, goofy masks when they were performing, especially a song like A Day in the Life. So I don't know if that, but anyway, that came into my head of what a fun gig that is. You know, you're a classically trained musician and you get to go and make cartoon music all day long. Especially about these types of gigs, what's really hard is about it is they have a new show every week.
Right.
These composers would put up these multiple tracks in a week. And you know, and they have to be just as fantastic as this.
It's almost like soap opera actors. Say what you will about soaps, but mm-hmm. they had a new script every day to bang out every day, or mm-hmm. on live television, where you had a new episode every week.
Mm-hmm. And like what we're talking about earlier with South Park, every week, you know, a new episode.
And they bang days under the deadline.
Yeah. And sometimes you know an event will happen in the week, and they have to. You know, they suddenly find inspiration for that, and they immediately do the show.
Now, say what you will about South Park. I'm sorry, Tony Award-winning Trey Parker and Matt Stone, but the South Park film that they did, it's wall-to-wall music. Mm-hmm. And if you've not seen Book of Mormon, or if you had, you should really say what you will about the cartoon and the content. But I remember watching it with my wife, who's classically trained, and she was like, that's Sondheim, that's Les Mis. That's this. That's, you know, it's Landry
Very
Lloyd Webber. It's just naming one genre after another. They know it really well. I was just say the Onion newspaper. They have a legitimate writing section called the AV Club, and this every week they do an introduction to a particular pop culture. And this week, because it's Halloween, it's the Hammer horror films, the British horror films of the 50s and 60s and 70s. And those horns always remind me of that. They're not subtle. In fact, my wife knows if I'm watching a period film because she can hear the really abrasive horns and, you know, kind of over-the-top orchestration. She goes, 40s. Or if I'm watching a Christopher Lee vampire movie, she's like, are you watching Hammer Horror? And I'm like, yeah, I'm watching Hammer Horror. So.
And this type of music, it's kind of hard to be, you know, put in some movies now. You can't watch, like, The Dark Knight or something like that, and then you have this type of Mickey Mousing going on whenever they're chasing each other or something like that. It just doesn't work. But we have these other type of techniques that can help that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll show you another one. This is called Composing with the Action. So Composing with the Action, you're actually with the motions that they're doing. You do not want to, if they're talking in dialogue, you do not want to cover up the dialogue. A lot of composers sometimes do that, and it takes away the integrity of the film. But with this, it's an action.
Are you going to make me acknowledge that there are three Matrix films and not one?
What do you mean?
This is from?
The second one, right?
Yeah, there's no second or third one in my life.
Are they all just one giant?
No, just the first is fine.
Oh, okay.
When you think about your choice, think about how you felt when you make your choice, and think of, I mean, Yoda would tell Lawrence Fishburne to shut up. Sorry.
Oh, no problem. But the composer for this is Don Davis.
Yep.
And this is Composing with the Action. I like this movie anyway. So as they're having this giant action fight scene, the music is mimicking what they're doing. It's not really Mickey Mousing because they're not following the motions, it's being this giant epicness. Pretty much this ostinato beat in the background. Goes right back to the whole act of fighting. But you get the idea for that. The music fits the action, mm-hmm. and it's giving the intensity to help the film push along in the fight scene.
I'm curious because this made me think of, and this is not a snark, it's just a legitimate thing, but music in video games.
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming I think it's obviously gotten better over the years since since Mario.
$1 billion industry.
Right. So, I mean, I'm assuming it's a similar approach as far as finding music to go with the action in the game itself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The music of a character fighting or driving is going to be different than the music of a character walking.
And this is a whole different topic, but
right.
What they do for that, they have to use certain loops whenever you're playing, because if you're actually in the game, sometimes they have full tracks that go on, but they have to loop, and depending on what you do, usually they have certain markers. But exactly, just for that, they even have a lot of film guides. You know, I've done a few video games since I've been doing films, and it's the exact same approach.
Cool. And your third?
Oh, yeah. And the third one, this is actually called Composing Against the Action Compared to the Other. I'm actually going to play it without music at first. This is from Varsity Blues. And I want you to just think, I kind of gave away with saying composing against the action, but what type of music do you hear in your head when you see this scene? This is the very last part of the football game, and they need to get his touchdown to win the game.
Chariots of Fire.
Stuff like that? Okay.
All right, interesting. Acoustic or electronic Vangelis style? That's... John Williams version, okay. Well, I know, because there was that period because of Vangelis where, well, a lot of musicians lost their jobs in the 80s because they were able to have orchestra, electronic scores.
Mm-hmm.
But they, I guess it sort of worked in Chariots of Fire. I think a great example of where it did really work and fit was Blade Runner.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, but yeah, okay, that's cool. Any other thoughts of what you think of when you think of when you're seeing that scene?
I think he hasn't. I don't know if he has an idea or not.
It's okay.
Anyway,
all right.
So this is called composing against the action. Not what you thought. The composer is Mark Isham, and he's actually a trumpet player, so the majority of his films he actually plays for himself.
It's kind of like Dave Grusin and piano. Two things come to mind with that. One is that film owes a lot of thanks to The Longest Yard when it comes
definitely.
To well, any sports film in slow motion. So there's that. But when I first heard that, I immediately thought of and I asked him, was this inspired by Randy Newman's score for The Natural? Because it has I think that's a similar feel to that.
Mm-hmm.
Same idea of. You expect, I think, especially if it's in regular speed, you would have a slam bang kind of thing. But
right. But
because it's slowed down and it's heightened,
it really works. And the effect is just as good, you know, doing against the action like that. And then it even sets up whenever he gets the touchdown, even more. You know, hits that big pivotal chord at the end, and boom, everyone feels good.
And hooray for the big fat kid!
Yeah,
he gets the score. It's
only
cool.
In real life, he'd probably just get the ball and get hit.
I say Refrigerator Perry would have a word with you about that.
So. Okay. With all this important, all this put together, everyone know? Do y'all know the movie The Shining?
Yes.
Okay. Hopefully, but okay. So everyone knows this as a classic horror film. Your classic, like we were talking about earlier, like kind of like a haunted house, but.
And that was also kind of electronic. The score itself was electronic.
Mm-hmm.
And works really well in that
right.
setting.
Now this is a different take on The Shining. Just showing the effect of how what music can actually put into a film. So I'll play this. It'll speak for itself pretty much.
And it's amusing.
Meet Jack Torrance.
I'm outlining a new writing project.
He's a writer looking for
inspiration.
This
is The Shining as a family comedy.
Ideas. Good ones.
Meet Danny.
Hi, Mr. Torrance.
He's a kid looking for a dad.
There's hardly anybody to play with around here.
Nah. What's up, Doc?
Jack just can't finish his book.
I don't want to sound melodramatic, but there's no way to make it economically feasible.
Here's to 5 miserable months.
But now, sometimes, what we need the most is just around the corner.
Someone's going on a road trip.
I'm your new foster father.
I'd do anything.
Climbing up on Salisbury Hill.
I love it.
I could see the city light.
The only thing missing is Jack Nicholson holding a boombox over his head if we're going to use Peter Gabriel music. Gosh.
And as we know, that's not really how the movie goes. But
no, not at all. Not jeez. Nice. That was, yeah. No. By the way, Peter Gabriel, Last Temptation is Christ's score. Mm-hmm. Amazing. Amazing. So there, shameless plug. So I guess I'll ask, when you get a job, you know, how do you compose a piece?
Well, first of all, after sending the thousands of messages to directors and developers, you make friends and they finally, okay, we want to use you for the film. All right, we locked you in. Usually you have your contracts and stuff like that. But they send you your film, and I actually use a program called Logic Pro. I can go into all the details for this, but I pretty much get a film, and I load it in here, and I have all these sound libraries that to my disposal. A lot of them sound just like the instrument. Or after that's done, I can send it off to an orchestrator. They can check it out, rewrite it, or I can even record it myself, which I've done a lot. So this is a film I actually did, actually a web series called Force Push. And this girl here, have y'all ever seen the movie Madeline? This is the little blonde girl in the movie with pigtails, and then the principal throws her all the way across the playground, and I don't think you see her ever again until the middle of the movie. But so, I'll get a film like this, and I'll load up, get all the ideas. I'll sit at a piano for a little while, and I literally did this in the car up here, just seeing what I can come up with real quick. And
you should have said you've been toiled over for hours the night before.
I'll show the final version. All right. The one I did toil for hours upon hours.
Okay, the angst-ridden musician. We need that.
But so I load up these sounds. These are very horrible. These come with the Mac as soon as you purchase it, but I just want to show you an example I do. I load it up, have a little keyboard, and let me pull it up, and we go. So you get the idea. I load up all these sounds in MIDI format. Well, man, I can literally, if I had my keyboard here, I can play all the notes as it is, and I can get a general idea of the sound I want. And at home, I have all these sounds that are amazing, and they literally sound just like a live player. Or, like I said, I can actually go and record a person and put them in. Now, the final product of this, for this little montage, what's funny, what you're going to hear, none of the instruments are actually real. I mean, they were pre-recorded, but all these instruments were pressed at a keyboard. I use a lot of Mickey Mousing and stuff like that. This is her trying to find her, her force powers, and then they always say everyone with a force power, they need to have a weapon. So this is her little montage of trying to find her weapon of choice.
How many scores have you personally worked on?
Too many to count at this point.
All different genres?
All different genres. Really, a lot of horror recently.
Really?
A lot of horror recently.
Why is that, do you think?
I think a lot of, this is the year, or the years to come of the indie film. Mm-hmm. A whole bunch of independent projects of people coming up with all these different types of films, and then horror, honestly, is easy to make. It's easy to produce, I believe.
I was going to ask, are there staples of musical pieces or musical effects or musical moments in particular genres? I mean, we talked earlier about the horns,
right.
Kind of hammer and horns. Is there is there something like that? How these bits from an action film compared to a comedy, compared to a mystery, compared to a thriller?
I would say, obviously in horror you have more of a crunch sound. A lot of times they'll have violins playing the highest note they have in seconds across each other. You're just getting that crunch sound. Maybe a lot more spacious to make it the watcher, the viewer, feel uncomfortable. I would say for a lot of action they have more percussion, drive, and all that stuff like that. And just like this is more of a comedic effect, so I kind of went like a Thomas Newman way and did something from like The Sandlot.
Okay. I think of also what's also almost a staple in horror is the use of quote unquote innocent music as a foreboding, something even like a music box or an old nursery rhyme song or something like.
A lot of times, they'll do bam ba dum ba dum whatever.
Yeah, and something then, something
know,
is.
Someone walks in here. Now, and that's okay. But one thing that's really irking me right now is the whole score, Alice in Wonderland, The Return of Wizard of Oz.
Sam Raimi with performance artist James Franco.
The whole film is this Danny Elfman beautiful orchestral score, and then at the very end, I think it's a Katy Perry song.
They've done that for a while though.
I disagree with that. Okay. Why would you want to have a whole score of that? And then have a Katy Perry song at the end.
Just gotta have people to buy the soundtrack.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, that's the single that'll go on the soundtrack.
Since you brought it up, and part of this is incorporated with Tarantino in concert, which will be a week from Friday. I say, hands up if you're going next week. Okay, so you might hear something like this next week. What I find fascinating about Tarantino, besides I still think he's a wonderful filmmaker, but his music of choice, he doesn't hire Thomas Newman or Mark Isham if anything he will borrow music from Ennio Morricone or Lalo Schifrin and use it. But not only his use of pop music, because he's brought a few old songs back in. I think he helped put Al Green back on the map, and Steeler's Wheels, and even to a lesser degree, Bobby Womack with Across 110th Street. But I think the selections of his music from the quote-unquote one-hit wonders or the old 70s rock staples and Reservoir Dogs to the mixture of styles of when he starts Pulp Fiction with a Dick Dale surfer instrumental, and then you can hear him change the channel on the radio and it goes to Jungle Boogie by Kool and the Gang. That's really cool. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's really effective. And then to incorporate not only music from other films, but music from different eras.
Right.
There's a film that he's used music from a couple of times. It's a 1973 Burt Reynolds movie called White Lightning. And he plays Gator McCluskey, a moonshiner and driver and Hellraiser and all this. And the music is done by a guy named Charles Bernstein, who also did the sequel Gator, among others. He's used music from White Lightning in Kill Bill, where the bride is meeting the 88 assassins. He also uses it in Inglourious Bastards, which is set in World War II. So the, you know, and the fact that he uses a hip hop song, which it borrows from The Payback by James Brown, Django Unchained, and using Jim Croce in Django Unchained. By the way, the best use of Jim Croce in an action film is not in Django Unchained, but in the last X-Men film. If you've seen that, you know what I mean. But it's almost become an orchestrated version of sampling. I mean, you know, it's, first off, hip-hop's not going away. I remember people were complaining about rap and hip-hop in the 80s, calling it a fad. You kind of feel like your parents else. Rock and roll, don't you? But the fact that partially now sampling, so the originators of music get critics. But the fact that he's taking pieces of music here and there and incorporating them into the film, and it works. I think across 110th Street, which the score for that, it's a 1970s crime drama with Yaphet Kotto and Anthony Quinn. The composer of that was J.J. Johnson. The title track was sung by Bobby Womack, and Tarantino uses it not once but twice in Jackie Brown, which is my favorite Tarantino film. At the very beginning, when Pam Grier is walking through the airport, I could watch Pam Grier walking through an airport 24 hours a day on a loop. My wife pats me on the head a lot. And then they use it at the very end for that gut punch ending where Max and Jackie are not going to be together. So I think that's a great example of being able to reuse a song, recycle it, and make it into something different.
And he is known for that.
Yeah.
I mean, in the industry.
It's kind of don't care attitude. He'll,
right.
He'll do whatever he wants.
It's almost expected.
And if you like it, that's great. And if you don't, well, he's still going to make them until he can't make them.
And speaking of Kill Bill, you know, he even added Bernard Herrmann in the hospital scene.
Yes.
He even had her singing the melody as he was walking
yep.
down. And you know, that's just what he's known for. It's, like I said, it's almost expected of him now to
do something.
These, yeah, even from different eras.
Correct.
Usually, like you said, in all these films, you know, even if it's 30s, 40s, he uses stuff from now or before.
Yep.
Just I think it's because we're at home and we know these charts, we know these tunes. Kind of puts us more closer to that.
And so to make a film like Django Unchained, and he used the music from the 1966 film Django,
mm-hmm.
starring Franco Nero, who also had a cameo in it, which was cool to see the two Djangos together. I highly recommend, if you like spaghetti westerns, like the Clint Eastwood, Sergio Leone ones, check out the Sergio Carbucci film Django. It's muddy and grimier and dirtier. Not in that way, but it's a little more guttural violence than the Leone pictures. And it's got Franco Nero in it, which is very cool. I lost a second.
Oh,
so
no,
it's all right. So the other thing that we've talked about, I've had the film show for 5 years. I've been reviewing films in Indy since 2001, and you know, school and doing all that. Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel, huge influences. And there's always a discussion amongst audience members. And I've heard composers say this. Yes, I'm the person that watches all the special features on my Blu-ray. But I've heard some composers say, if you don't notice the music, the score has done its job.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that's entirely true. I also think there are two types of audience members. There are sitters and there are thinkers. If you're and there's nothing wrong with one, and sitters can think and thinkers can sit, but I think you're rooted in one or the other.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a sitter, you watch the movie, you let it wash over you, you like it, you don't like it, and
right.
you go home. A thinker, you,
mm-hmm.
yeah, and maybe also because that you have a hand in it, but you're.
Movies are almost ruined for me now.
Right.
When I go to
we'll
the
get
theater.
To that.
Yeah.
So you're like, oh, that acting moment was cool, that angle was cool, I like this music.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't mind if I hear Hans Zimmer beating me over the head in Inception or the Dark Knight series or Ennio Morricone, who's my favorite composer.
Mm-hmm.
I absolutely get giddy over it. I try to let my daughter pick her own stuff. I'm like, honey, listen to this score. Listen to this, you know, Once Upon a Time in the West. It's really cool. But I don't mind noticing
right.
the scores, the John Williams scores. Even, you know,
and those are hard to come by. You don't really hear John Williams-y scores anymore. A lot of it's just in the background, you know, as a some type of just beat
mm-hmm.
in the background, or it's hard.
Can anybody hum the theme from Lincoln? No, I guess not. Okay.
Seriously.
Yeah.
You know, maybe that's the way the music's going in that, you know, they want it to be in the background.
So I don't know, but I kept thinking of, or it's like who can I hum? And I think of, there's a wonderful composer named Rachel Barton,
mm-hmm.
who I know. First thing I noticed in was appropriate left the film Emma, the Gwyneth Paltrow, the Jane Austen novel. So I think she's done a lot of those. I think she did Il Postino, but kind of soft period pieces, not you know your art house pictures. I think of I love saying this, Academy Award winner Trent Reznor. For his score in The Social Network, and he did Gone Girl.
Can
and
you hum any of those?
No, I can't. No, you really shouldn't hum Nine Inch Nails in general. But that's one where I know the music's there. Mm-hmm. I couldn't tell you what it is, but it's also very effective. So you, how's it watching a movie with you?
It's almost ruined in a sense because I a lot of filmography, whenever they do, they have certain scenes. You see a film, like, oh, that's the same type of cut, type of the filming.
It's an homage to this. It's a cut to that. Yeah.
So the music guys, we do the same thing. With a lot of death scenes in movies, I don't want to ruin it for you, it has the Dies Irae in it. Yeah, it's going to happen. You're going to hear it. If you go listen to it, you're going to hear it now. But when I'm watching a film, like, oh, yeah, that's that theme. Oh, yeah, they're doing the homage to that. Oh, that's a 12-tone row. Stuff like that, and you start noticing that if you really look into it. And I mean, it's not ruined. I loved it. I really love it listening to it. I'm like, oh, that's cool. That's so that's what they're doing. And then you have Hans Zimmer with ba ba ba. That's cool too.
Well, there's I remember. I'm going back to South Park did an episode about Inception. It was their own version of Inception. And what's funny is, some guy is trying to explain what is going on, and while he's doing that, there's another guy behind him. Yeah, going. As my buddy Brian Hartz has a film blog, and he's like, it's 4/4 and lots of cellos, not enough cellos, more cellos.
And the percussion is
right. Has there been a film as soon as you sat down the score just kind of threw you completely off whack?
Shutter Island. I did not like the score to Shutter Island.
Who did the score
Hans
for
Zimmer?
I didn't.
Three notes the whole score. That's fine, for that type of movie, but literally only three notes the whole score.
Wow, so it's a CD single if they still made those. I guess I want to open it up to you guys if you guys have any questions or if there's a film score that you like that made an impression with you. Yes, sir. Come on up. Yes, I want you to come up. Walk to me. And by the way, great
second,
sir.
Dun, 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 dun.
It seems that you guys like Hans Zimmer, and so do I. One thing I have a question about, he did the music to Gladiator, which is my favorite movie ever. And then I saw Pirates of the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. There's no difference between the scores of those movies. So my question is, what's up
why?
With that?
Thank you. What's your name?
Denny Allman.
Hey, how you doing? Thank you. That's more up your alley.
Well, also, a lot of it depends on the director as well. Sadly, they hire these composers because they have this sound that they want. You have this sound. I want.
Give me 4/4 with lots of cellos.
Give me 4/4 with lots of cellos like you did in this movie because it sounds really cool. And to the common, to the person who's not maybe as musically inept or something like that, the music's in the background or something like that. A lot of times with Hans Zimmer, the music is in the background. I'm really happy that you noticed that. Yeah, just like action music. The whole Pirates of the Caribbean, all this whole 6/8 stuff, dum 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 dum, whatever. And you remember the melody, but it's all in the background. And he's almost made a monopoly of that type of sound, and everyone wants it. Everyone wants it.
We were talking. If you notice, because we also do the IMDb thing, but a lot of directors, there's a lot of director composer pairings. Steven Spielberg and John Williams, Danny Elfman and Tim Burton,
Hitchcock and Herman,
Hitchcock and Bernard Herman. Side story a little bit. My first piece of radio creativity at WFYI. I used to have the shift on Sundays from 3 to 8, and at that time at 6 o'clock we had the Indianapolis Symphony Orchestra, and that show went from, it could go anywhere from 50 minutes to an hour, 25 minutes. And I would have to take the allotted, the rest of the time until 7:30 to pick out a piece of classical music to play before opera matinee with Stephen Stolen. And to not embarrass myself or the station, I kept trying to find, you know, a lot of Joe Smiths with the Toronto Symphony Orchestra playing Beethoven, you know, pieces I recognized. But I came across a collection of Bernard Herrmann scores from Hitchcock films, and it was October. And I played, one Sunday I played Psycho, another Sunday I played Vertigo, another one was Rear Window, and I got calls, I got compliments, I got notes from management heard. And so for many years on Sundays, I would pick out film scores to fill the time. And it was great because back then, Dick Rice, our old classical music guy that used to be on, his desk looked like a bunker. I mean, he was just piles and piles of CDs on his desk. So, you know, if there was a collapse, he was going to be safe. Mm-hmm. And I remember going to him, asking him if I could take the scores. He's like, yeah, it's less CDs on my desk. Mm-hmm. So those started to come in. I started going to half-price books, and anytime I could find a score of note, I would use those. Right. And that was so Bernard Herrmann's always had a very – Bernard Herrmann helped me out a little bit in his the other one, if you remember, how many people remember the film The Artist? Won Best Picture a couple years ago. Yeah, that was another example. He did a Tarantino thing where you heard music from Vertigo, and of course I love Kim Novak, but she was went a little off the deep end and kind of screamed to the press about the use of the music and thought it was very inappropriate. But effective. I thought it was effective because of that chase near the end, and you hear that, you're like, oh, it's that.
The first time when he picks up the cup, you know, you hear the sound.
And it's one of those, it's almost like if you don't know it's from Vertigo, it's still effective. It's still a gripping piece of music. But, you know, there's just that little extra, like it's like the recognizing the music in a Tarantino film, I think. So. Mm-hmm. Anybody else have? Yes, ma'am.
I wonder if you could talk a little bit. Oh, thank you.
This is for broadcast. We need this.
I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the influences of the...
it's like Donahue.
About the early, the wonderful composers from the classic era of films, like Herrmann, which you've mentioned, but also people like Max Steiner.
Oh, Max Steiner, yeah.
David Raxon, Eric Korngold. Mm-hmm. And for me, you know, when I was growing up, I was seeing all the reruns of those great movies in the afternoons after school. And it seems as if those composers knew how to bring out the emotions so well that when you were seeing the film, just as you talked about earlier, how the music, the images are not really anything without that wonderful music. And I wondered if you could talk about those composers and if they influenced you at all.
Oh, definitely. The original, like Max Steiner, he is known as the father of film music. The first original score was King Kong, and first original, all the other music before that, you know, they kind of plugged music in, but the first score that was was asked to write was King Kong, and a lot of those, you know, the early composers, they were classically trained, and you know, I think also because of all the silent films, their music was able to take more shape, and you know, you could have melodies, you could have all this, you could actually right over the dialogue. So I'm a very melodic person. I love melodies. And because of all that, that has really influenced me. Stuff like Casablanca and, you know, King Kong and Mighty Joe Young and stuff like that. Those early films, they really...
I'm thinking about the Max Steiner films, Saul Bellamy Davis' films.
Mm-hmm.
They all borrowed from all the
classical.
Together and producing that beautiful energy.
Right. Oh, yeah. It's really, I mean, in order to have a full orchestra, you know, you have, there's few composers now who still write by hand. John Williams is pretty much one of the only few people who still write. You know, he does one film a year, and all of it, most of it's by hand. And sadly, you have to have the budget to have a full orchestra like this for all these big films. And you're also writing a two-hour, you know, 2 hours worth of music and however many, you know, how much time you have. It is sad. You know, you cannot have these very, you know, large tracks like that, you know, that really speak to us in these classical music. A lot of times people kind of plug it in, old stuff that we know and stuff like that. But you're right. The music like that is becoming kind of stagnant and minimalist, you know, stuff like that.
To piggyback what you were saying, I do the blues show on Saturday nights, and I talk to musicians about how, as far as doing research. The beauty of film and music is there's always a genre, a title, a person, you know, something that you haven't seen yet. I'm, you know, there's, we act as if we've seen everything, and people say I give that aura, but there's still stuff I haven't seen yet. And so when you had a musician like Eric Clapton or Stevie Ray Vaughan who would cite who influenced them, you know, they would talk about Buddy Guy and Otis Rush and Muddy Waters and the Three Kings, Freddie, BB, and Albert, you know, and it was like, if you like my stuff, go check out their stuff. And you can kind of tell over time who does and who does not. And I think that's the same thing. If you enjoy the Tarantino films, then hopefully you're checking out the Morricone films. What I love about Morricone, because by the 50s and the early 60s, and of course that's the decline of the studios. That's another story. But I think even film scoring by that time was becoming a little in place, right. complacent. And the fact that Morricone would take an orchestra, but he would add literally bells and whistles and electric guitar, which was unheard of. And he would have not singing, but vocalization, you know, from The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly to, you know, people will still debate what is actually being said during the credits of A Fistful of Dollars. Mm-hmm. And it was just taking something that was familiar and just tweaking it enough. You know, the use of the harmonica in Once Upon a Time in the West. Right. And yes, I know Zamfir is kind of a punchline, but his work in Once Upon a Time in America is amazing. Just great, great use of that. And I love the fact that he took an orchestra and just added a little twist to it. Mm-hmm. And that's become an influence since.
And, go ahead. Oh, yeah,
Nina Rota.
You could put anything that Nina Rota ever wrote, you could play it, and you would know it's Nina Rota, because he's got a style of his own that's very unique. And I wonder how you, as a composer, having a style that in Rota's case is so wonderful, so it's just beautiful music, but it's also, it's his soul coming out in that music. It's him, you know, it's Nina. And then how you work against that, and then the commercialism of having to sort of cater to all these, this mediocrity.
It's hard. You know, being able to give your soul out. You know, in this music, you have to follow the form of the
dialogue. You have to do this. It's almost like I'm running a piece and the director is telling me, you have to do this, this, and this with these guidelines. And sometimes, it's, you know, I have to put a piece down for a while and just wait because the structure of it, I can't do it sometimes. Because I want to put my, you know, put as much effort as I can so it sounds like me into this and with all these guidelines. And, you know, that, like I said, that can be really hard.
And put in 4/4 with lots of cellos.
Right. I'll tell you a story. Sometime this one of the last films I did, they sent me, usually it's like a giant PDF or something like that, of, you know, times this to this, this to this, this to this. And every time it changes, it's always different. I submit everything. I'm like, oh, you should do this. Add 30 seconds here. And this is a waste of time on my part, but I always write a little extra, you know, extra. I'm like, okay, this would really fit right here. This needs to go right here. Please put this right here. And, you know, at the stage of where I'm at right now, I believe I can get away with that a little bit. Please put this right here. And then sometimes I'll be like, ah, no, not really. Or if they say, oh, you should have music here, you know, if you should not have music here, and then they say you do, you know, you should. You know, it's kind of counterbalances. I did this one I did a horror film, and at the very end, they added this little pop song.
By Katy Perry.
Right. So, but the whole film is this horror thing, and then this whole pop song. And the theme I had was two violins half steps apart going throughout the whole thing. You can't hear it. You can barely hear it, but it's there. And I asked, please, during the pop song, can I have these two violins playing this? No one can notice it, but I want it there. And we did it, and it's, you know, to me, it makes me happy, just knowing that these two violins are on top doing these little half steps. So
it's like the scene in Amadeus when the guy's too many notes. Well, which ones do I take out?
Right.
You know.
Too many notes.
Exactly. Yes, sir. Hold on, we got the Phil's coming with us. Thank you, fans of Morning TV.
I'm glad Herman got so much mention tonight.
Gosh, yeah.
Is it Saturday or Sunday? I got to look at my calendar. I've got my tickets. They're showing Psycho with the live
orchestra. Yes, that's right. That is, oh.
That's at the ISO.
Wait, no, is it Saturday?
Saturday night, 7:30, I think it is. I got my tickets.
That's a great, I'm glad you mentioned that. That's a fantastic opportunity to have. That doesn't happen very often.
To see a film, well, Psycho and, you know, the time of year and all,
Janet
Psycho
Lee's not
was
be
a.
There. Don't do that.
Well, Psycho was such a film with so many firsts.
Yes.
And it was such a groundbreaking film in so many ways, musically also.
Right.
And, you know, if you get a chance to see it, please do. I don't know what availability is, but.
Well,
by all means.
A flood of calls now, so that's cool. Yes, most definitely. Last summer, my daughter and I went to Chicago for the Blues Fest, and we had an early morning. And there's a great theater if you're ever in Chicago on the North Side called the Music Box. It's a great art house, two screens, and they do midnight movies every weekend, and then for every Friday and Saturday night, and then every Saturday and Sunday morning they do a matinee of an old classic movie or musical, different from the midnight movies. But on one particular Saturday afternoon, we got to see, I wish I could remember the title, I apologize, but it was the only silent film of Gloria Swanson and Rudolph Valentino together with a live organ accompaniment. That added to it. It was one thing to see, because she had seen silent movies, but never with live organ. And it was really, really special. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad you brought that up. Woof. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And music now is such a goulash of all these mix of genres. It's hard for someone, you know, to be new, you know, recreate the whole scene because of all this, different types of genres of music there is. Imagine when the first theremin came out, in the movies. You know, an alien.
Plagued by every sci-fi horror film of the 50s and 60s.
And that was scary. And now you can't really pull that off.
Well, you could. But
you could, but it would be taken differently. But
that was Herman.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Yes, sir. Oh, hold on. She's coming.
This may come from a little more of a layman's perspective, but what is the process like in making a score for a film? In that you talked about the Mickey Mousing in, let's say, like the Matrix film, where you had specific hit points where how do you get the film first and then you score to the film, or do you get the score and then they kind of edit it to the film? I kind of makes me think about the Lord of the Rings movies where each character kind of had their own kind of theme song, and it would depend on what they cut to, in that in that specific scene, who they would, what kind of music you would hear. What's that process like, and what's the editing kind of dynamic there?
I would say it's probably any album, you know, all between. Most of the time, they send me a film, and it has a temp track, something that they, their idea of what they want there. Oh, we want this here, and they say we want. I'm gonna be honest, they don't know what they want. You know, so like certain hit points and stuff like that. Yeah, that's pretty much up for me to decide. You know, I think you should have this, this silent. But a lot of times they have a temp track, and I follow that, you know, as much as I can. And then I'll have their themes. You know, I'd like to be intellectual a lot of times, so each person will have their themes. I'll do the whole, have them playing along with each other, flip, whatever. And so just like that, whenever they send me a film, I write it, write the themes and all that. But however, sometimes, I'm going to try and go with this. But they'll actually edit the film sometimes to a certain, music. I'll give them a track like, oh, we love this track so much, don't edit it. We'll do something, we'll extend this somehow or something like that, even if it's just a room or something like that. So honestly, the answer is all of the above. So, I mean, I have a lot of, say with the hit points I use. You know, certain punches, certain kicks, some, like my Mickey Mousing in the film I showed you. You know, there was, when he pointed the sword, every one of those had a hit. A lot of them you probably didn't even notice. Whenever the guy ran, a little snare was in the background. Stuff like that. Bells, whenever he did that. You know, sounds whenever the gun comes out. But it, you really, you don't understand it, but it's there and you feel it. And it, I think that helps push it along.
Anybody else?
Yes.
I guess I'm interested in your education or how you... Okay, how you got interested in doing this, and just your
oh,
history.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I went to Ball State. Oh, you, right.
Actually, I went to undergrad at Tarleton State University for jazz performance. So there I learned all my theory. I loved theory so much. And since I started composing jazz charts. And since then, you know, I was such a film movie buff, and I wanted to have a successful living writing music. And I did the whole education route, and I just, I had this certain passion. I wanted to put music to film to where I can get this certain emotion that I would feel sometimes when I watch these movies. So I worked for a year after my undergrad, you know, performed all and all that stuff. And then every summer I would go to L.A. 2 years ago I stayed a whole month with Christopher Young. He did the music to Spider-Man 3, Hellraiser, and stuff like that. And I would always meet different composers. I met John Ottman, Tyler Bates, you know, the Guardians of the Galaxy, X-Men, all that stuff. You know, I pretty much just, I asked them all the questions I wanted to know. You know, everything. What can I get out of this? And then I talked to Dr. Shelley here. You know, I wanted more depth in my music. I felt like I was kind of going in blind. You know, I could write all these melodies, and I feel like that's what a lot of composers do now in film. They have an interest in it, and they just do it. Danny Elfman, he was in Oingo Boingo. And he didn't know how to write a single note. You know, he had Shirley Walker, who was his understudy, do all the music. You know, he would say, oh, here's the theme for this, and write this out. And, you know, she should be, you know, accredited a lot for that. You know, he writes a lot now. But I came here to Butler to get a lot more, in you know, depth in my music so I can give a more intellectual score to make myself feel better and to also, you know, provide a better product. And since, you know, then I go to L.A. every year, you know, multiple times a year, and I just talk to every single composer I can.
Before we wrap things up, one other composer I just need to name drop. I never met him. But it's the, say what you will about the film, but anytime I see the credit, music by Ry Cooter, who great guitarist who did films for a lot of Walter Hill films, Crossroads, Southern Comfort, yeah. Also worked with Wim Wenders on Paris, Texas, Trespass, Geronimo, lots of stuff. Mm-hmm. But, you know, acoustic guitar, also worked with the Buena Vista Social Club in the late 90s. Very cool, very fun guitarist, and did solo albums in the 70s, still does, but seeing him do film work with the guitar, and especially acoustic guitar at the front, that's also a rarity. So. Randy Newman's going to be in Carmel next month, so we should all reunite and road trip up. We'll tailgate.
Well, I mean, you know, he's not just, he's Randy Newman.
I mean, because that he was almost like Susan Lucci for a while. He was getting nominated constantly, and then finally got one.
He finally made it.
He was the first one to say, "Thank God, I finally got one of these."
But late November in Carmel.
Cool. Meet you at Bubs. So. Yes, sir.
All right, there we go. The simple question is to you, does music lie in film? And where the idea comes from is certainly the early music used in film was directly came from the use of music in opera.
Right.
So the themes, as that gentleman had said, or the leitmotifs, they were always associated with a particular character. And when a character would come on stage and say, I don't love her, in the background, the music was playing her theme, her leitmotif.
All the time.
So you knew the character was lying. And I was just wondering, in the use of film, is the same thing. Can you lie with the music, go against what really is the truth of the action?
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I'm trying to think of this one film. I think it might have been Mind Joe Young or something like that. There's a love scene, and you know, it shows that they're very passionate, and in the background, the music portrays that this love will never happen. They'll never keep this love.
You're talking the original, right?
Right.
Yeah, not the Bill Paxton, Charlize Theron
right,
thing.
Right.
Yeah, just check. Sorry, just checking.
And you know, this is a love that will never happen, no matter what. And to me, you know, that's the intellectual part. If you can portray that, you know, interlocking themes that happens all the time, and it's beautiful. You know, themes backwards, or whenever someone's telling a. You know, interlocking themes and having these two people love each other and their themes are go, or the two people that you haven't met yet, their themes are already overlapping, you don't know. So all the time, definitely.
Anything else? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, just a reminder, Tarantino in Concert is a week from Friday. I'll be back here. I won't rehash all the old jokes. Film Sociology, you can hear Fridays at 5 and Sundays at 4 on WFYI HD2. The show is also available as a podcast. It's also available on iTunes. You can also listen to the show on WFYI.org. And then the Blues House Party is Saturday nights at 8 on WFYI. Occasionally, and if I ever hear blues in a film, I'll play it. I stay for all the credits. There was
Crossroads.
I've actually played Crossroads. Although we talked about no way Ralph Macchio beat Steve Vai in a guitar duo. Never. But like this summer, Jersey Boys had a harmonica instrumental from Charlie Musselwhite, and so I played that. So that's kind of how it works. No call from Clint though. I'm working on that. So, cool. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for hanging out and chatting. We appreciate it.